But I'm a fan from 100 Thieves and I play Marksman. The journey towards from 100 Thieves was a bit of an up and down one, I would say. I think we started off really hot as a team and we were kind of stomping the competition, and then we had a bit of a slump and it was a bit difficult for us as a team, I would say, but we pulled through and in the end we managed to win the finals. In my opinion, a good team requires you to be pretty good friends, and that's what we are, so. This is going to be my first world, so it means a lot. I want to show exactly what I have to offer on the international stage. If we were able to make the run and win this world championship, I think that would be the biggest accomplishment of all of our lives. So that's what we're going to try to do here, and hopefully we can do it.
And here we are, jumping into Champions Life for DFM versus 100 Thieves. Getting ready for yet another game. Both these teams starting off 0-1. DFM featuring or experiencing the fury of SKT, rather T1 firsthand. Sorry, Joe. And 100 Thieves experiencing EDG. Both of them bodied in their first game, to say the least. But now they have a chance to start fresh. They have a chance to come into the group stage swinging in their second games, and we'll see what they can bring to the table. They've already got 6 bans.
Yeah, the Aria LeBlanc last ban there from 100 Thieves, I think, is extremely well situated for them, trying to take away this assassin from the mid lane, especially as it is one of his most proficient champions. Meanwhile, for the side of 100 Thieves from pick and ban phase, so much of their success in regaining control of the top of the ladder in the LCS was when they fully committed to having Closer be their giant second carry. And they have full commitment of, you know, Fiego picks for him and his Lee Sin popping off. Whereas the first game here in groups at Worlds with the Jarvan pick definitely deviated and kind of lost a lot of people along the way seeing that change. Bottom lane, though, has been so reliable for them. So with the Aphelios ban, they go for the early Lucian pick here. You always expect it to be paired with the Nami for a super powerful lane phase. FBI and Huhi have, throughout the entirety of this team's history, been such a strong carry force from the bottom side. So we shall see what Yutapon and gang have to match into it. They grab the MF on the backside.
See if they now on the side of 100 Thieves want to immediately go for the Nami. You expect it would be banned away in the second phase if they do not opt to select it here. But instead, it looks like they will try to match jungle. Hold that thought for a brief moment. And important to remember from both those games yesterday, it's the Nami in the end, that the bot lane was volatile on both sides. Now, for FBN, who he lost summoners in an early lane where they really wanted to be winning. For Yutapon and gang, they got aggressive on the Jhin Yuumi lane, and ultimately it turned against them when they weren't able to connect maybe some of those kill shots, weren't able to really make that all in work. So expecting more from both of these bottom lanes today, and certainly when you got a Lucian Nami on one side, you are set up for an explosive laning phase.
Yeah, I think a lot of it came down to attention to detail and level one ward placement for them, getting the early vision and the early safety. But do like the fall up here, ban away that Leona anytime you have Miss Fortune. Definitely such a scary offensive combination. The heavy targeted Urgot, a little bit of respect there as well. You love to see it. Trying to take away some of the signature ones, and it's going to leave open some more possible jungle bans at closer. I actually am quite glad they ban away the Jarvan from him. Maybe get him on a little bit more carry-oriented champion from the side of 100 Thieves.
For now, though, it looks like Graves is going to be the potential pick up here. They could opt for jungle and wait, though, on this last pick, but Graves obviously such a just a powerful pick overall. It certainly wouldn't hurt to lock it in. It is still technically a flex. We've seen Whipple play it in the jungle. Most people have been playing it top, but flexibility never hurts.
Especially when you are red side on your 4 pick. It keeps them guessing a little bit as far as their top lane matchup, so then you have to do something like this. The Gnar, which it can be very neutral, not going to be super overpowering for it, but can handle even if you do decide to do a lane swap and put it into the jungle. So you like that there from Evie trying to be versatile and provide the team a little bit of a buffer. The Rakan immediately gets locked in, though, there. This thing has been so, so deadly as far as the combinations you can set up for Miss Fortune. Lightning quick engages for the ultimate and set him up the exact same way. The Viego that we mentioned, Dracos, he comes back. All right, let's lay it out, though. Yeah. Got nerfed. Let's be clear. Since the highlight reels of Closer turbo carrying through playoffs for 100 Thieves, they significantly hit the healing on when you collect your soul. So your pop-off pentakill chain moments are a little bit more difficult, especially when you're in a 1v3, 1v4 situation where you've seen some of the more frustrating gameplay from this champion. Also some other small things. You know, they increase the radius where you can actually detect him when he's in the mist. And the other things are a little bit more insignificant, but the chaining and the heal that you get back from it is something that can hurt if you're banking on just the reset possibilities for the champion. But they've just been so good at utilizing it, and him being such an offensive force from the jungle, this is kind of more what people want to see from 100 Thieves at Worlds here. So see if it stacks up versus Detonation Focus Me.
Certainly, and expected to be a big improvement from the Aatrox J4 topside that they had yesterday. Whatever had worked out for them previously obviously did not show up as well on stage. But you are against Elise and Gnar now. Heavy notorious for a small but very, very focused champion pool. Gnar, one of his big picks, played it twice during the play-ins alongside some Urgot, alongside some Set. He played the Set yesterday as well. We'll see how he handles this lane matchup now. Range advantage obviously feels all right for Gnar. You have the Boomerang, but in general, I'm really convinced personally that Graves is just way too friggin' strong, so I'm ready to see what Someday can do with this champion, and have to find out exactly how we can play this lane phase out as we get into this one. Remember, both teams 0-1 right now, need to find that first win. Miracle Run is always possible, but if you're losing to the other team alongside you near the bottom, that miracle dream dies pretty fast.
Yeah, the positive thing here for Out of Champs Select for 100 Thieves is they got their pushing lanes to work with for Viego for the offensive effort. Meanwhile, on the side of DFM, Arya on one of his comfort champions with the Zoe here can definitely have some big bubble picks, especially if you are the jungler. Have to watch out whenever you're rotating through and around mid lane, because the burst damage coming through, if just a bubble lands, him plus allowing Steel to get in location, is definitely openings for burst.
And Arya did feel like the strongest individual laner that we saw in the DFM versus T1 matchup yesterday. It was Orianna versus Zier. Now, it wasn't the greatest lane phase, and eventually the deficits from his allies did flow over into the mid lane. But for most of the early levels, he was going toe-to-toe with Faker. Now, those aren't the two most explosive champions, but it is a good sign as we look ahead towards this matchup against 100 Thieves. That said, Amadagi, just going to walk forward, lay down a little bit of early vision. You highlighted it in the last game. I think in general, just so important to track early jungle pathing. We're not seeing the new junglers here. Yes, Lee Sin, Viego, very much a matchup we every region got used to in playoffs. And of course, you were banning the Lee Sin. But now at least DFM going to have some good information. And while 100 Thieves will not see exactly where Lee Sin started, by seeing where he hasn't started, they'll have a pretty good idea.
And, you know, a decent amount of people dropping Viego as a priority jungle champion. It's moments like this where you get those nerfs where you basically weed out the party bus Viegos that are just jumping on whatever's popular at the moment. And the true Viego aficionados, connoisseurs.
Yeah. Are you here because he's powerful, or are you really committed? Are you the edgy boy with the eyeliner who fully wants to commit to the bad high school boyfriend vibes that Viego brings to the table? We'll see what Closer is going to be here in this one. For now, though, early pressure very much going in favor of the Lucian and Nami. Not too surprising there. Rakan level 1, not super powerful overall, whereas Nami, you know, she's just got a lot of really strong abilities. The E I never used to worry about, but with Electrocute and the Imperial Mandate and the Lucian buffs, very strong. The W has historically always been ludicrously powerful, so we'll see how long they can keep this pressure up bottom side, as we do have a little bit more vision laid down on the top side again, on the side of 100 Thieves, trying to keep track of where the jungler is going to go.
Yeah, this is what you always like to see when you have your pushing top side matchup. Someday on Graves, easy access to the wave early on, push him in there with the Gnar, affords you, like you're talking about earlier, the jungle tracking. Easy process of elimination early on when you get your deep Gromp blue buff ward over there. They know exactly where he is. The defensive ward comes out, though, as you can see in the river up towards the early ramp by Raptors. They already pre-placed it for Detonation Focus Me, so no surprise invade on the Raptors or Red from Closer. Has to go down through the river, finish up to secure this bottom Scuttle Crab, and even set himself up for two. He skipped his wolves to do this, though, so there is a cost to early access to the river, as it's a very nice trade on level 3 here from the 100 Thieves bottom lane. Giant chunk, but there is a cost. You know, Closer skipping the wolves, usually you'd have the 4 camp clear and and be able to get your double scuttle, but with the early entry into the river, has full vision and can easily get them both.
And this is exactly what you highlighted when you saw this draft, Kobe, is that the early prior lanes are going to free Closer up so much, and now it's freed him up to take a double crab to kick things off. Definitely the start you'd love to have for Viego.
Yeah, bottom vision, they do have their tri-brush ward in place. So you can see FBI and Huhi do a good job of kind of playing dumb down there, like staying in lane just long enough to make Lee Sin use a bit of time to hover around them while still keeping up their pressure, but backing off before you can complete an all-in. And now it is sort of a trailing invade here to find those that wolf camp that was left up by Closer to sacrifice for his river protection. But because their support is going to help with the jungle invade and look for the mid dive, bottom is under attack. Amadaga is going to have to flash up towards top.
Amadaga needs to get away from the knockup, and now the kick could connect. If he manages to hit Amadaga, it's going to be big. It goes wide, but the auto attacks are going to finish the job. That's first blood going over to the side. A detonation focus me. Closer here to pick up the wave. Arya very low, though. Has to be careful. Picks up. Ooh, lucky item pickup there. Gets the extra movement speed coming in from the stolen Yomu's passive, and now just smacking right back onto Closer.
Beautiful surgic removal of the 100 Thieves mid laner there by DFM. Just even though they get dodge on Abadaga's flash there, they force him to the side away from the tower so they can still complete the dive.
Very close. Huhi now flashing forward. One more auto. He's going in, but the shield comes in with the Rakan. Huhi still manages to get him. Just barely on the edge there, but 100 Thieves bot lane find the kill.
That's the price you pay. Utapon, longest standing member on the team. Over 820 games with this organization. And he's left alone under the tower versus Nami Lucian. Even by the time the gang gets back, it's not quick enough. And FBI and Huhi make them pay for taking down Faker Dage.
Yeah. And at the end of the day, what you look at the value proposition, that Lee Sin is ahead, but bot lane is bleeding very fast. And again, the execution here, good. The patience on the Lee Sin Q. I said it's going wide, but ultimately, as long as you throw it that way, you're guaranteed to finish the job with just auto attack.
Yeah, so they get out the flash there and then steal because he has ward hop. Lee Sin, ward hop right next to you. Now you have no way of getting away from Q except for sidestep dodging, and with all the dodging away from the tower. See if they get a repeat, though.
This is a replay.
Aha, we get a repeat. 2 hours of sleep, my friend. Whoa, is that crazy, Daniel? They killed him again. Oh, man. Thanks, Axe.
That was the Kobe effect replay right there. Probably the jet lag effect replay right there. But maybe we see it repeated. Maybe you're a prophet. That's just what you're bringing us back to. And again, things very good right now for 100 Thieves in the early game. They did have complete control of the bottom side. They're having to fight back a little bit here. The flash forward from Closure, though, they're immediately going to kick things out. The bubble does manage to connect. That should be one dead misfortune. Utapon going down. That's the reset.
Prophet, you see? He gets this one as well, so it is a repeat Closer.
Oh, that's not a caster curse. That's just a profit. But Arya doing big damage onto Abadage, trying to get a kill back in the meantime. But Ryze, obviously, a ton of sustained damage. That's the ignite, that's the flash. Abadage now trying to make it out, but Arya with a clean solo kill.
Arya on comfort is a menace, and that's why DFM focused him early on. Able to get this one out by himself, taking down Abadage. No flash left from the previous time. Nice chase down and answer because the bottom side, huge alarms going off for DFM. It's becoming a huge problem, especially with Closer going down there to play off their strong lane and picking some up for himself. Now they're just looking to repeat.
That's a level 6 Viego. No, Spectrumon not going to connect. Gangcore still has tank. He is with the Resolve primary, but they have to be careful here on this dive. He managed to get a little bit more damage. FBI now dashing in on the Lucian. It's just so easy. 100 Thieves found the weak point, and they're focusing, and that's the double kill over to them. 2-5, the kill score now. Someday, maybe we're going to try to get something done here. That's a level 7 Graves. He's stacking armor like a madman off that True Grit. That is not a fight that DFM can tank.
Yeah, Someday defending a bit of the jungle there. Get some of the Krugs for himself. Meanwhile, the rest of the team and Closer on the pick. Sometimes you look at the fans' responses, and you're like, oh, yeah, you want to see him on the Viego because he stomped. Well, guess what, guys? Yeah, he got nerfed. Doesn't matter. They are right, okay, Dracos?
Everybody, fans are always right. They said, no more Jarvan.
Get him on Viego. Bam. Get him on carry. Guess what? Yeah. It's definitely set up by bottom lane and helps so much with the investment in Lucian, Nami lane down there for the 100 Thieves. But having Closer on the Viego, getting these kills as well so early on in the game, gives you just so much more confidence for this team.
Yeah, I mean, and again, incredible early game from 100 Thieves. Big turnaround from what we saw against EDG. Now, Denny shows me, maybe they can find a way back into this one, but this big of a deficit, only 8 minutes into the game, 2.5k gold, massive leads for the Lucian, massive lead for the Viego, is going to make the entire game quite difficult. And you can see Steel maybe fishing for a little bit of pick here, fishing for a bit of vision, but not really going to get much out of it.
Just happy to see some MF on the receiving end of a lot of DPS this time around. Really well utilized here by Huhi, by FBI, because Gang went to go roam. You cannot do that against this offensive bottom lane, not get punished.
Really good wave from Huhi. Very slow skill, but he lines it up perfectly. He finds him against the wall. Yutapon now set to fall, burning, ticking from the Ignite. FBI gonna grab that one.
Over and over again. Love it. Going through the super strong lane, just forcing. And in the long lane here, Yutapon doesn't even use the heal, knows he is dead to rights. That one's going to result in more objectives for here. 400 Thieves. Dragon picked up. They can begin their stacking. Almost all of the turret plates have already been worked off by hand down here. No need for a Rift Herald, which will be traded over to DFM. They know they've lost control of bottom side, so your best option in these cases is try and trade something on top side. Pick up that Rift Herald. It's your consolation prize, plus Scuttlecrab spawned up there, so you get a little bit of extra.
Yeah. It's going to result in maybe 300, maybe 600 gold, of course. But in the meantime, FBI is just breaking bot lane tower at 9 minutes, almost 10 minutes.
He's breaking their mental down there, too.
Yeah. If your mental is not broken after this one, that's incredible. Shout out to DFM if they can hold on. But that is one very powerful Lucian, and he's only going to get stronger. He's sitting on 1.8k gold and was sitting on about 1,000, I think, in the last fight anyway. So he's going to return, maybe finish that first Mythic. On top of that, Huhi grabbing a couple kills as well means he's very close to the Imperial Mandate. This is a murder lane.
Draco, so because I'm so jet-lagged, I need another check. Is that one a replay? Because we just had another defensive Krugs by someday. He's getting his money's worth.
This is really happening.
That was facetious. And yet, he's playing his weak side well. This is one of the things where someday didn't get a lot of credit this season because so many of the other 100 Thieves players had carry roles throughout the entire split, but playing weak side quite well because of all the bottom focus and their bottom carrying so hard. You know, keeps backing off, defends a bit of Krugs, doesn't get dove, doesn't give up any deaths, staying here within reach.
Yeah, and I think it's just so difficult for DFM to try to push on anything in the top side, and someday winning his lane on his own, taking Krugs away, defending the top. Their options are running out very quickly, Kobe. We're 10 minutes in, and I'm already just trying to figure out what DFM do to survive in this game. 100 Thieves are taking everything. They don't believe in like the slow, steady push forward. They're like, we're stronger than you. We're taking all of your jungle, all of the vision, all of your towers.
You for sure cannot fight on the Lucian Nami. Mandate and Kraken Slayer are both finished. These are two carries. Like, their DPS output from this duo is insane. So you have to try and trade somewhere on the other side of the map. But they're sending more resources here to try and collect on, I guess, the Nami bounty, because there's not even a big bounty on FBI since the kill credit, a lot of them were going to closer. And it just seems like, to me, an unnecessary uphill battle trying to fight into the biggest strength of 100 Thieves when you have the option of trying to trade across on the other side of the map.
And I think the downside here especially is that Ahri is currently pretty much the strongest point for this team alongside Steel, and you're committing them both to the top side, which means in the meantime, Awadage, who was struggling a little bit in lane, is now ahead in CS, got a ton of time alone in that mid lane to just farm up. MF forced to move in and catch that wave, and MF can't even sit comfortably in that lane. She now has to leave, has to try to go somewhere else. Maybe she can catch this wave, but if 100 Thieves want to commit for the dive, immediately you can see DFM already roaming over, knowing that this is something that 100 Thieves could do if Yutapon is left alone.
Their hope for shutting down FBI is either a flash play from Gang on Rakan, because he's now level 6.
That's going to be the root into the knockup, into the bubble. That's a ton of CC. Lucian doesn't even need to participate. Nami, the real carry in that one.
Exactly. The bounty's in the right place, my friend. Who he heads over, adds to the CC. Awadage easily collects that one, though, just waiting in the brush, and that was a ill-fated invade. Now might be a dive on the other side.
But now that they know Ahri is not in the area either, Closer now moving up. Is he going to be able to connect on the stun? He's going to do a ton of damage. He's asleep for now. Arya trying to fire back, but at least zoning the Zoe away. Now, there's not enough of a wave to force an immediate dive here, so you're going to sit comfortable for now. But, of course, just surviving right now costs DFM a couple tower plates on the top side as Awadage grabs more gold.
Yeah, they're at least clearing out some of the vision between the turrets to try and open up avenues for rotations. But if you see, Closer just strong-armed Arya there in order to defend it. Puts down another control ward. You see the control ward right there by blue buff. So both sides of anyone rotating over to defend these waves get sussed out, and 100 Thieves continue to prey on them. So you basically continue to increase your lead by taking away as much as you can from DFM in setting up for another dragon here. 1 minute away should be easy river control for 100 Thieves. They've already got the bottom side tower down, and after rotating someday over there, they can easily now go step number two, put your deeper wards into the red buff quadrant of DFM's jungle, thereby seeing them, if anybody tries to come up and poke around this dragon, which they definitely shouldn't for DFM, then you can punish them accordingly. Nami ultimate will be back up, so you have the long range tidal wave to be able to throw it through the jungle. You know, through that jungle corridor is your best option of trying to find those picks, because much more difficult to dodge.
And I think overall, 100 Thieves' surgical precision here as they push their vision line forward. They deny more and more from the side of DFM. DFM doing what they can to respond on the opposite side of the map, but there's just not a lot there for them. Yes, they're going to get some vision, but there are no camps there. And it's difficult for the LJL representative. First time in groups, come out to a difficult loss versus T1 and potentially another difficult loss here against 100 Thieves. I think there had to be some optimism coming into this game after they pretty triumphantly won over C9 to make it here in the first place. But at this stage of the game, you're grasping at straws and you're holding on. This is the classic pray for late game moment where you just hope that maybe 100 Thieves overextend or overcommit or get too aggressive, because at this stage of the game, you are weaker in fights. They will hit you with their wallets.
100 Thieves doing Cloud9 a solid here.
Yeah, redemption.
We got you a little bit of revenge there. The dragon is up. They actually not in any rush to pick it up, it looks like. Full reset, going to catch topside wave. DFM made the attempt as far as, oh, if they send any straggler for a weak side trying to defend topside turret, then we'll punish, but nobody to be found, so no extra gold over there. 100 Thieves, the only thing they have to keep in mind now is when you're trading sides of the map like this, after strong siding so often on bottom half of the map, you have to keep in mind that, yeah, there should be a lot of vision left behind in our red quadrant. So you'll see a little bit of hesitation before moving into that quadrant. There could be the surprise brush play. Those are things you look at now as the game progresses with this sort of a lead. You know, multiple people setting up in your brush to try and surprise you there. And so then you just wait, move with multiple ascents. You don't have great face checking tools. Wait for closer to come over, and then you can safely get in there. You see the pings are already going down from them. Once they get the resets, move over and sweep it out.
And between Steel and Aria, you have a ton of tools that you can use to find these picks, to find these isolated targets, and really to make it work in that context.
I don't know if this is, if anyone else could hear this, but your voice just got way deeper for me.
I hear it too.
There was some audio change. I was like, whoa.
I wasn't going to talk about it.
Am I dreaming? Am I dreaming right now?
I'm underwater.
This is, I like it. This is.
Sometimes I think
this is the Dracos. The Dracos audio pack. I know you've got some vocal skills with all the rapping done, we'll but are you a triple threat talent where he's going
to
start
you
doing some...
You want me to, like, ASMR the Rift Herald? What do you want?
I was going to go, you know, with voice acting. Next thing we see you in is, you know, some animated short. But, yeah, the ASMR is big right now, man.
ASMR is good. I feel like there's probably more money in one than the other.
I would subscribe, okay?
I appreciate
Tier 3
that.
Subscription coming from me as soon as you open up your channel.
That's all I need to hear, Cody.
I'm in full support.
I think we're back. I think we're good. Okay, maybe. Yeah. I don't know. Maybe we're used to it now.
It's actually you doing it, and you're trolling me, and you're doing it on purpose.
No. I have no idea. And the best part is we don't even know if the fans can hear anything that we're talking about, but they can see this Rift Herald charging, and they can see 100 Thieves grouping on the top side to break down this Tier 2 tower. Relentless pressure forward, 6K gold lead. DFM, we'll see what they can do. They've got some burst damage to work with. Not enough to win a team fight, but maybe enough to find a pick.
Yeah, I mean, again, as we already referenced, it's like, all right, let's use our, you have to coordinate your sweeper cooldowns and your control wards to move up line by line to find these brush to try and set up your surprise play. You've got Gang here with level 6, with flash ready. And their sights are set on someday. Look at Ryze, though, heading down the lane. Abadaga can use his Realm Warp to get there in time.
No.
They better be quick about
TPs,
it.
TPs, they're going in. Someday dashing through. They've got a bit of damage down. Leeson goes wide on the kick, though. They knock him back to the bush. Evie's trying to finish the drop. Someday running for the hills. Abadaga, can they save him? He's still alive. Graves is still alive. It's disaster. Oh, no. And here comes the Realm Warp. Here they go. Gang running for the hills. Evie running for his life. He's going to go Mega. Maybe he can throw him back to the wall, but closer. Just relentless. If he gets this Gnar, it's going to be big. But Evie throws him back now. Arya laying down damage from downtown. FBI moving forward, but FBN Huhi cannot contribute to the fight, so for now, a few members of DFM get to walk away. Oh, big knockup. Nope.
Big, huge, gigantic, massive.
the gnarly wave, bro.
Hey, man, it puts the mandate thing on their heads.
That's true.
That was
marked for death, large. You would say. I was
Big McLarge huge. That's what that reminds yeah. me of. But anyways, back to the play that just happened. Yeah, you have to be quick about if you're pulling off one of those attempts at the big comeback play on the split pusher, because this is the thing that most people always complain about with Graves, is how deceptively tanky he is. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. You know, with the True Grit, yes, but also the shield bow builds, being able to have that shield to rely upon, you know, he's able to buy plenty of time, and the rest of the 100 Thieves collapse, and you get punished in the aftermath. So every attempt you take, if you don't quickly complete your objective, then you get a little pain on the way out. Here it yeah. is. I like the setup, you know. Kick him right in, you know, Ignite used early on, so he doesn't get as much out of the lifesteal, but too much evasive maneuvers there. Ultimate away to Abdaga. He didn't even have to use a Realm Warp to get there in time, so he uses it for the chase.
Yeah, and in the new Axe Effect replay, you can see once the play goes even a little bit south, 100 Thieves are so far ahead that they just keep going, basically, until the tower stops them. Until they have to literally dive a tier 2 to kill people, they will just run over you in a fight. So DFM, maybe they get one or two more opportunities, but every time they go for something like that, it does cost them a little bit more gold. This deficit continues to stack against them. We get later and later in the game, Baron around the corner, and this team pretty good at killing Baron very quickly. Yes, they don't have a tank, but they do have 4.5 DPS threats with this Nami.
I love this strategy. You know, some of the new MMOs don't even have tank classes, and they go with the same strategy where it's mostly DPS and a healer. That's what 100 Thieves have drafted. 4 DPS and a healer.
Wow. I always played tank because I had bad hands, but now it feels like there's no place left for me.
Well, you've got to be healer, I guess.
So, knock up, now going in. Someday, though, not a man who's going to go down quite so easily. All the 100 Thieves running down towards the bottom side of the map. Again, DFM going for the collapse, but 100 Thieves can just move down to bottom side and look at that tier 2 instead.
Yeah, they've got their pick of anything on the map, basically. Bottom side tier 2, turret into dragon into Baron is my gamble. Good defensive ward line there from DFM with the control wards, but the wards can see them coming. You still can't do a lot about it.
Yeah,
so we need to look at what this kind of means moving forward for this group, because 100 Thieves, they did drop their opening game to EDG, but EDG sure. is looking absolutely phenomenal right now and poised to top the group, as most people expected. But I think some of the things to look at are the adjustments that 100 Thieves made in this game. You know, a lot of people talking about some of the things in Champ Select, but also the early decision-making, where it was a bit lazy from 100 Thieves. Not what we usually expect from the preparation from the level that they usually come out with, but this time around, playing so well around their win conditions, aggressive on bottom side, then also reacting to the commitment of resources from DFM towards mid. Yes, they punish Abadaga and he goes down, but it's about your response. And Closer going down bottom side after FBI and who he already opened up their kill onto Utapon, punishing the roam of the support. Those are the types of things that you look for, regardless of how big now the game is kind of turning into a blowout.
Yeah, and I think ultimately it's good that if you're going to lose to the first place team in the group, because there's still room for you if you can beat SKT. And yes, that would still be an upset, but if you can beat SKT, even if it's just 1-1 and EDG's in a 6-0 kind of situation, as long as you don't drop, you know, the next game against DFM, you're in position for a tiebreaker. And that is a massive opportunity. Now, admittedly, NA doesn't have the best history with tiebreakers, Kobe, but there is a path out of this group, and I think that is a big deal.
That's a good ad for, you know, the most interesting man in the world. I don't lose a lot, but when I do, I like to lose to the best team in the group.
There you go.
Perfect strategy.
I thought maybe you were going to say tiebreakers. I was like, that's
no, I wasn't going to go there because that's, you know,
that's
one of those
dark,
too real type of jokes.
It's the dark place. We don't go there. One step at a time. First, you got to make it to the tiebreakers or even just make it out without tiebreakers. That'd be sick. But for now, they need to close this game. Again, 22 minutes in, massive, massive, massive gold lead. We are 3 minutes away from a soul. Baron is up and available. All it will take is maybe one or two picks for DFM to lose that one entirely.
And I like that you bring up picks, especially coming out of the previous game, because previous game, you know, Cloud9, split pushing with Ryze, a lot of effort needs to be put in to securing these avenues for Abadaga to pick. You just see him pushing very far on top side, but they have the ward coverage through the jungle to allow him to do that. And he backs off before getting picked. Now starting up Baron, forcing them to come through their own vision.
Gnar bottom. He's about to turn into Mega. This could be big. This is maybe the only opportunity they have to fight. If he turns Mini again, they're not going to have anything. 100 Thieves do not want to fully commit for this one. Meganar coming in. Maybe this could be the big fight. But again, the timing a little bit off in the bubble. This is an opportunity for Evie, but it might be the only opportunity they get. 100 Thieves not going to take the bait. Not going to overcommit to the Baron. They start that one, get a TP for free.
Now, do they actually want to collapse? Because they use the Kuki Flash FBI heal. Not very large cooldowns from them, save for the flash from Huhi, but all they really got was the teleport out of Evie.
True. Closer, now gonna make it out. Good news is, you're right, I missed the cooldowns there, and that is an important move for DFM. Maybe they can capitalize on it. Huhi has been very fortunate not or to make it out scot-free in all these situations. 2-0-5, obviously the ideal scoreline when you're playing Nami, but he is very squishy.
Yeah, if you're as far behind and you're picking a kill target, you're looking for definitely the squishiest easy kill target.
No more someday.
The Nami with no flash sounds good. Yeah, you're looking at the herd and you're like, we must pick off the straggler from the herd.
I gotta bring out the world's class analysis, Kobe. Hit the immobile champion who's very squishy.
The level 9 support down there with no flash. Got it. Achievable goals. I mean, honestly, they always tell you that.
They
have those surveys of the top CEOs of the world. Like, you know what? You got to make
break
a list.
It down.
Break it down into achievable goals.
Yeah. Okay, so the big picture goal is win the game, but the little goal, the goal right in front of you, the baby step
is kill that flashless Nami.
Kill that flashless Nami with a bounty on her head.
She does still have a bounty.
I mean, everyone has a bounty at this point. It's very, very 100 Thieves' favorite game, but all it takes is a bunch of shutdowns, a one team fight, a Baron, and a couple Drakes, and DFM can be right back in this.
Because of the lack of tank you were talking about earlier, maybe they're a little bit more hesitant to stay on this Baron and sustain some of that damage. I would think, though, with Nami and with all the lifesteal on Viego, they should be able to continue to bait, continue to return to it. And remember the cooldown that they got out of the last one. Guess what? It was teleport from Evie. That is still down. They should be able to try and abuse and use someday's teleport advantage by split pushing on bottom and then teleporting over to the Baron. You would think to end this a bit quicker. And this is one of the things where you take a microscope to your games. Great changes by 100 Thieves in the opener. However, everybody's going to be critiquing from this point on out how cleanly you execute on that split map. And the only reason they don't want to force again on Baron and just use that teleport and his Baron to home is because this one is actually soul for the cloud. So they pull off the Baron and they just wait for the soul. Take this one, you get your guaranteed big boost in power. Then you can return to it. And you'll still have a decent amount of time to try and leverage that teleport discrepancy. Plenty of DPS, plus your healing. Return over there, clear out the vision wards, force it through, and have someday complete the play.
Yep. Still a decent teleport flank ward if they want to go for it, but obviously Graves not the biggest teleport flanker, not the biggest team fight powerhouse. See what 100 Thieves want to do next. Free soul, easy access, not the most combat stats, but I don't think they need them. They still have a very healthy lead, 8K in their favor. Happy to have the extra movement speed, though. Certainly will make it that much harder to lock them down and find these picks inside of DFM. But DFM seemed poised, ready for what could be one final team fight, as the Culling is now coming out. Bit of poke damage. Evie Rage is stacking. But as long as 100 Thieves wait for the Meganar to fall away, definitely take the fight.
So I wanted to see either a Realm Warp to try and pincer or a Realm Warp to move a minion wave up. But they don't have a minion wave mid to move in and try and push quickly, so they'll just push one more and return to that Baron play we talked about. Force it. As far as their turn goes, you really only have the Nami wave, so your turn's not that exceptional unless you do something fancy with the Realm Warp and Abadaga flashes and you know, Rune Push and something like that. But I guess a lot of it is going to be on Huhi as far as the turn and trying to find that big knockup.
100 Thieves, though, really do not feel comfortable starting this. Of course, yeah, there was the blue trinket up and available, but now Evie is going to be able to start and stack the Meganar again. They're taking a lot of poke just to step forward here, but the same is true for Evie. Closer waiting in the darkness. There goes the wave onto Evie. Immediately, you're going to see the Rakan go for the knockup, but he just gets locked out and taken down. Now's the Realm Warp going in. That's the Gnar Guard as well. 100 Thieves just so far ahead of Flawless Bubble.
They got the Nami, though!
It's a shutdown, but that's going to be it as they turn back to the Baron. A lot of low health bars here, though, and still three members of DFM standing.
Goal achieved. Bounty acquired, Dracos. They did get him, and Arya still poking around. I think these are low health members of 100 Thieves.
And we're gonna wait. I don't think they're gonna immediately start this one up. Yes, Unipon doesn't have an ult, but Arya is still scary. 2.5 item Zoe can do a lot of work if they lock themselves in that pit.
So I think two things here. Even with the extra kill for 100 Thieves, DFM successfully waited out the cooldown on the teleport from Evie, so they will have the answers for Force Split Push. But here's a look at the Force. This one, as soon as the Nami wave comes out, you thought that, or at least I thought, they were going to disengage, but that was the exact same time when Gang forced his flash engage there. 100 Thieves, beautiful deviation there where they just get outside of range and then kill him. But caught in the edge of the Misfortune ultimate, the Nami does go down. With the tower shots, it gets a little bit shaky for 100 Thieves, but they can just return right to the site of the Baron. Clear out the wards once again. Still not split pushing down there for the bottom side of the map, though, so there's not two areas of pressure forcing DFM in any direction. Still gonna kick him in.
Viego back, the knockup is there, the CC will be up. Closer goes Golden for a brief moment. That's the calling across the backside. Abadage coming in on the flank, a wave across the pinch, but everyone is going to make it out. DFM now retreating, pulling back, but FBI wants to keep the fight going. Kick connects, but not a whole lot else. MF ult is big, but not enough to finish kills. It's just a trade of blows.
So now 100 Thieves, they have Nami, they have the healer, so they can sustain up, try and repeat here. No Nami ultimate as far as the turn now, though, so it's even a little bit less dangerous for DFM. Some critical flashes. They did use the flash from Lee Sin for your flash kick play.
TP mid. Baron being started up in the meantime. Someday in Abadage, will they turn away? Yes, they do not want to overcommit to this objective.
Aria.
Turning back and forth. Aria! We asked for one, and he gave us two. Second death coming in for Huhi. That is the vulnerable member. DFM, insanely high risk to start this objective. For now, they'll settle for clearing out this vision. And what do we say, Kobe? Baby steps. Start by... Step two is not the Baron, but they're going to go for it anyway. Now committing. TP on the backside. A lot of major ultimates missing. Someday can now step forward. Evie just now starting to stack rage, throwing out the boomerangs. 5K, getting lower. It might just come down to a 50-50. Closer, no flash, but he has the ultimate to get to the pit if he needs it. Steel on the backside, alone in the pit. FBI getting locked up. FBI, is he going to get taken down? The deathmatch safety, he has the GA. He's bought himself a little bit more time. He's going to come out. Evie there waiting in the darkness, going for the ultimate. Going to knock two into the wall, but Someday still standing. It's a mess. It's an absolute brawl. DFM running for the hills now. 100 Thieves too strong. They couldn't finish the Baron, and the attempt is going to cost them. Abadage looking to finish off Yutapon. Yutapon running as fast as little MF feet can carry him, but who he here for a little bit of fishy revenge, and Abadage now unstoppable.
All right, well, not exactly the cleanest, but 100 Thieves are inside the base, Dracos. They chase them down off of the Baron attempt there, and this is going to be huge punishment. Abadage used the Realm Warp. They chased down the Stragglers on top side, so with MF still in the graveyard for another 30 seconds, Evie as well, that's going to be two objectives in one. They start up the Baron. He's going to sustain him in the pit after the inhibitor, should be able to pick that one up, and then use the Baron buff to walk right back down. Looks like we were perfect timing lining up for an Elder Dragon as well, so they can finish up Baron of Power Recall, get back to base, and have plenty of time to supplant it with control wards around the Elder Dragon. That also gives you time for your top lane super minions to move up and create the pressure on DFM's base, putting them in a real crunch.
Yeah, but at this point, 10K gold lead, 11K gold lead with Baron. You get Elder 2. It's a victory lap. And again, you talk about judging 100 Thieves, getting a little bit more particular. They built a big lead. Now we got to see how well they close it out. If they cannot close it cleanly with those buffs, that's a red flag heading into that all-important matchup versus SKT. At T1, man, it's years of habit. I'm sorry, Joe.
Honestly, if you didn't keep mentioning it, I would not notice.
I feel like I have to. Okay. You know what I mean? People got so mad about 1907 Fenerbahce. Shout out to you. Maybe you're remembering that now. I feel like I got to get it in there. But now, the engage coming out. Some big damage there. Closer immediately taken down.
Well. What do we have here, Dracos? Another pick, and this one's on the jungler. That's going to be big. No dragon in sight.
Running. Gang, though, has to leap right back out to safety. They are still not strong enough to take a full-on fight. Gang running. Evio there in the area. They're going forward. Meganar might be big. They kick him back into the wall. This is huge. Abadage still strong enough to potentially carry a fight. Someday there in the area as well. Aria, what can he get done? That's one at least. Heal. Now taking him out to safety. Someday on the chase. Flashing forward. Auto in. Will finish it. Evio. Flashes the S to finish it. It's an absolute brawly mess, but 100 Thieves still come out on top, and they'll be able to end the game.
Faker Doggett, what was that? Last auto does come down to it. That's going to be the game, though. Draco Someday not wasting any time. He wants out of this. Baron buff, teleport over to the Nexus turrets, and 100 Thieves are going to wrap it up.
100 Thieves take the win. Dominant start. A couple question marks along the way, but overall, hugely commanding win as they move up to 1-1. Tomorrow, end of the first round robin, they face T1, and it is going to be a huge matchup to define, honestly, to define the group.
Yep, especially with, you know, EDG taking victories off of both of them. Sets it up to be one of those make or break decider matches for the group. Like some of the changes here for 100 Thieves, especially in the early game, the adjustments that they made. Very, very powerful use of the Lucian Nami early on to make their own advantages, then bring in Closer on the carry champion to really snowball it.
Yeah, I really liked what we saw just from the individual laning setups. I liked how well Someday played as the weak side of the map, you know, taking Krugs away. Honestly, how good does it feel as a top laner when you're like, you're taking camps from your jungler essentially, and you're like, I'm defending these from the enemy. Like, did good, solid, impossible to kill, and you saw that even when DFM tried to spot him out, tried to isolate him on those side lanes and force those picks, he still stood strong. Hui, of course, almost flawless game, but did die twice as the baby step CEO grind set instructed DFM to, you know, focus the little goal there. But DFM, you're praying for upsets, you're praying for miracles, but past that, we'll just have to see what they bring into the next game. 100 Thieves, I think, a little bit of optimism starts to set in. Yes, T1, a very big, very terrifying opponent, but maybe, just maybe, make it out of this group.
Arya showed up on his Zoe as well, something you always like to see, something you latch onto for, you know, star players there. So love the performance, but not going to be enough here to deal with the 100 Thieves as we march forward in this group. It's going to start to be a hole for DFM to dig themselves out of.
Absolutely. Kind of crazy to see the way that this day and these groups have developed a lot of close exchanges. Of course, we're soon going to hear from Abadaga, though, before Mad Lions look to bounce back with a win versus Gen G. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
They say where the legends come from. You know what a hero looks like. Other people on fire, fire. Maybe it's time they meet their dragon. Cause if I gotta
It all leads to this. Make or break.
Vitality will take them!
A new era is waiting.
What was that?
Make it yours.
And welcome back, everyone, to World's Group Stage 2021. 100 Thieves find their first win against Detonation. Focus Me and Abedagger, thank you so much for joining me. Congrats on grabbing this one. You're one of the rookies at Worlds this year, so talk me through your experience so far from facing Scout in the mid lane yesterday to grabbing a convincing win over the Japanese team today.
Definitely feels pretty new to be at the World Stage for the first time. Still have some stage jitters, and like there's definitely some pressure. But I'm confident that I'm going to perform well in the next couple of games, and we're getting used to it, and we want to make NA proud, so it's important to all of us to do well here.
Yeah, and it was a really, really cool game from you guys today. But I want to know, how does it compare to the experience you had in the LCS this year and before that in the LEC in terms of competition in the mid lane especially?
Well, they're all really good, and in my group they're all Korean, so and the best Korean mid laners are always really strong, so it's definitely a challenge, and this is the place where you can prove yourself, and I'm just looking forward to prove more that I belong here.
Yeah. Are you can you give me any thoughts on your group especially and how you think this one is going to play out? Because EDG is right now 2-0, but I feel like it's pretty open still for the rest.
EDG is looking really strong, but yesterday we felt like we had a really disadvantage like in draft, and we felt like they didn't actually pressure that well. Like they could have destroyed us way faster, so we were actually like a bit, it made us more confident that they're not that much better than us, and we actually have a chance if we prepare well and have a good draft.
Can you give me your thoughts on the meta so far, because it's something that I ask many roles, but not especially in the mid lane. We've seen a lot of different matchups, melee to melee, range melee, and yeah, it's so many different things. So how do you feel it suits your style so far, and how do you find it when it comes to the style for 100 Thieves as a whole?
We like to fight a lot from mid, and so it fits us pretty well right now, just playing like Ryze, LeBlanc and stuff like that. And me and Closer do really well contesting from mid, so I'm pretty comfortable in the meta right now.
Right, well, that's great to hear, because tomorrow you're going to have a big task, and I'm really, really hyped about this, because we will finally have the Faker-Dagger versus Faker matchup. How do you feel about this one and meeting Faker finally on the mid lane?
Yeah, I'm thankful to Riot for fulfilling the script. Like, my first time at Worlds, and Faker made it as well, so they obviously had to put us in the same group. It's going to be cool to play with him.
I can imagine. Well, we'll be looking forward to that. But for now, Felix, thank you so much for the interview. Good
thank
luck
you.
Against T1 tomorrow. And we're going to take a break now. And we'll be back in a couple minutes with Mad Lion looking to get their first win against Gen.G. See you in a few.